Okay. Thank you. So, thank you for your invitation. As you know, perhaps metrology is my preferred topic since the beginning of my short academic life. And I discuss a very specific problem, which is the relationship between the representation of metrology and what is said in texts. The measurement units used in administrative and mathematical cuneiform texts are represented in modern publication, including mine, of course, in diverse form, and especially tables and diagrams. These representations suggest that the measurement units form coherent, complete, and uniform system. In this talk, I would like to try to compare what is said on metrology by the ancient texts and what is said by modern representations. I rely on two sets of documents. The first one is composed of administrative and mathematical texts dated to the archaic and early dynastic period, that is, the end of the fourth millennium and the early third millennium. And the second set is composed of mathematical texts dated to the Old Babylonian period, that is the beginning of the second millennium, before the Common Era, of course. These documents deal with lengths and surfaces, and I'll focus on measure of lengths and surfaces. The first thing I would like to discuss in this talk, first I discuss some point of terminology. Second, how are metrology represented in modern publications? Third, which information or which ideas do modern representations convey that ancient texts do not? And I will discuss this question with the example of archaic and early dynastic field texts. Vice versa, which information or idea do some cuneiform texts convey that modern representations do not? And I rely on a set of documents, metrological documents from the Old Babylonian period. Of course, both questions held at the same time. It's not clearly separated. And conclusion on the question often asked by Agathe, system or not system? So, the question of terminology that I will use in this talk. This terminology is partially borrowed from the International Vocabulary of Metrology, which is a set of conventions produced by an international team of scientists, mainly physicists, in order to uniformize concepts and vocabulary of metrology. This team is the Bureau International des Poids et Mesures. This vocabulary, international vocabulary, has actually held both a universal scope as it, I quote it, covers the basic principles governing quantities and units, but actually has a specific goal as actually it was designed to, I quote it, meet conceptual needs of measurements in modern fields, such as biochemistry, physics, chemistry, and so on and so on. So, this is specific. So, in the context of the SOAR project, held by Karine and as well as Agathe and I, on the mathematical practices in the ancient world, we discuss this vocabulary and try to set our own terminology adapted to ancient texts. And in this context, I use, relying on this discussion, I use the following distinction. In cuneiform text, you can find expressions, in mathematical or administrative, you can find expressions such as lengths, measurement of lengths, written, a sign for three wedges, a sign for a half, cross, after that, a sign for a measurement unit. Here it's one ninda, which represent more or less 6 meters, and the name of the magnitude which is measured, here a length. Other example for capacity, you can find the number two wedges, a measurement unit, one sila, which represent 1 liter, more or less, and the name of the community with all magnitudes with it represented, that is here, grain, with the meaning, the broader meaning of capacity. So the you have the expression of quantity is decomposed into three components: a number, sometimes completed by a fraction, a measurement unit, and the name of a magnitude. The two first elements constitute the measurement value and a lexical sign for the name of the magnitude. This syntax is the most common, but it's not the only one found in cuneiform text. Other syntaxes were used in certain period for certain units, and I come back on this problem later. Other distinctions which are very important for analysis of text are the following. First, when discussing metrology, there are several aspects. One aspect is the absolute value of the measurement unit, that is the actual quantity which corresponds to a given measurement, for example, how many liters in one sila. This is exactly Serafina discussed just before, that is absolute value attributed to the units. Other problem is the relative value of measurement units, that is the factor which defines a measurement unit in relation to multiple or some submultiple. For example, how many sila in one bigger unit, which is gour. And the third aspect, which is extremely important in cuneiform sources, are the bridges, that is the connection, if any, between units related to a given magnitude with respect to those related to other magnitude, for example, the connection, if any, between length units and surface units. So the presentation first, so explore the following questions. I already read them. So first, how are metrology represented in modern publication? Here are two tables which represent the units of length in two editions of mathematical texts. The first one at the top is by Thureau d'Angin in his Tablet Mathématique Babylonienne published in 1938. And the second one comes from Mathematical Cuneiform Text by Neugebauer and Sachs in 1945. These tables are very, very interesting and rich in information, but I will discuss only some of aspects of them. Thureau d'Angin, as well as Neugebauer, represent the unit of length, surface, and so on in tabular format. These tables indicate the relative values of the different units of length in relation to the other. However, the representation differ on several aspects. For example, if you look at the notation of numbers, in Thureau d'Angin's tables, in the fourth column, the factors are noted in decimal notation with specified numbers, that is, the number is followed by the name of the measurement unit. But in the last column, the factors are indicated with sexagesimal place value notation, first in floating notation, that is without indication of the order of magnitude, second in absolute sexagesimal place value notation, that is the absolute value is indicated by the sign you see, second, minute, and so on. In Neugebauer and Sachs tables, the factors are noted in absolute sexagesimal place value notation with comma and colon, and the number are specified with the headings of the column. Other difference in Neugebauer tables and difference between Neugebauer tables and Turodangian tables, the list of units is not the same. Turodangian presents his table as un tableau des mesures usitées dans les textes mathématiques au temps de la première dynastie, that is, measurement unit used in the Old Babylonian period, while Neugebauer and Sachs consider only the metrological relations so far as they occur in the text treated in this volume, selection. And if you look at all of the representation of metrology, I think it will be impossible to find two representations which consider the same list of units. So the problem is that there is a selection of corpus involved in the representation of metrology. These representations of the metrology of length convey many assumptions through the tabular layout, the selection of units, the notation of factors, that is decimal or sexagesimal, absolute or floating, specified or non-specified, that is with or without a measurement unit. I will not discuss all of this in detail, but I think that it is very important to understand these assumptions. And for that, fourth part of my talk, I compare these tables with the representation of metrology developed in the Old Babylonian period by the scribes themselves. That is, what do they say with their own representation of the metrology, which is different, more or less, in comparison with these tables. Another sort of representation are the so-called factor diagrams, which are more and more used in modern publication, that is, trains of units connected by the factor which define each unit from the previous one. For example, you have at the top that 30 chaussi is one finger. 30 chaussi is one couche, which correspond to a qubit, which is a qubit, and so on. This convenient representation was introduced by Johann Friberg in 1978 and is widely used today. So you can see here two factor diagrams for unit of length, the first by Friberg, and at the top, and the second is the one we used in the Encyclopedia of Assyriology, which was published by the CDLI, that is the Cuneiform Digital Library Initiative, which is the same but vertical instead of horizontal and more or less information. So the factor diagrams raise the same problems as tables. For example, the list of units is not the same in the both diagrams. Friberg represents all the units in Neo-Sumerian and Old Babylonian systems for length numbers. And in the CDLI, we selected only unit found in metrological lists and tables from Nippur, that is a very restricted corpus. Another important issue are implied by Friberg's reference to length numbers in his caption, which raise the question, what is number? And more broadly, what are the elements of the measurement values? Are they numbers, measurement unit, or other? What is the function of these elements in the cuneiform text and, by comparison, in the diagrams? So my goal is not to criticize the use of representation of metrology, because these representations are indispensable for walking. All of us, we use it. But to analyze the distance between modern representations and ancient metrology these representations describe. I'll show how the different system of representation, tables or diagrams, highlight some features and alter or ignore others, and how they convey ideas which are not that of ancient actors, and vice versa. So, first question, which information ideas do the factor diagrams convey that ancient texts do not? The case of archaic and early dynastic field texts. In this part, I'll concentrate on some delimited corpus of texts dealing with fields from Uruk. Uruk is a city of the southern Mesopotamia, Jemnet Nasr in the central Mesopotamia, and Farah and Girsu also in southern Mesopotamia. These texts are dated to the following period, Uruk 4, and they come from Uruk. Uruk 3, and they come from Jemnet Nasr, and early dynastic 3A, they come from Farah, and early dynastic 3B, they come from Girsu. Just a remark, archaic and proto-cuneiform period are more or less the same, that is the Uruk 5, 4, and 3 period. That is the end of Neolithic period and the beginning of Bronze Age, if I use archaeological delimitations. In their landmark book, Archaic Bookkeeping, Nissen, Damro, and Englund provide a set of diagrams which describe the signs used to represent quantities in the proto-cuneiform text from Uruk. The first diagrams, at the top, represent the so-called system S, which is a sexagesimal, I quote the caption, system used to count most discrete objects, for example, humans, animals, and so on. Another diagram, the fifth, the so-called system G, is a system used to note area measures. Nissen, Damro, and Englund do not mention the signs used to represent lengths. Actually, the measurement of lengths appear in archaic texts represented by the element of the so-called system S, that is the sexagesimal system in the first line. Here, both are represented. As I said at the beginning, I compare the information ideas conveyed by this diagram and the features of a selection of texts from southern and central Mesopotamia and dated to archaic and early dynastic periods. These groups are 12 tablets from Uruk dated Uruk 4, 11 tablets from Jemnet Nasr dated Uruk 3, 2 tablets which are mathematical tablets. The other are administrative tablets. So 2 mathematical tablets from Farah dated early dynastic 3A and 15 tablets, administrative tablets from Girsu dated early dynastic 3B. For each group, I'll compare what is implied in diagram and text concerning the syntax, the magnitude represented, the repertoire of signs, the bridges, if any, between the unit of length and surface. In the group of tablets from Uruk, The tablet of this group provides the dimensions of large lands measuring between 30 hectares and 3,600 hectares. That is very large lands. The text provides either the areas or the length of the sides, but never both. In other words, the measurement of surfaces and lengths appear in separate tablets for different fields and never in the same tablet. In tablets containing surfaces, the quantitative signs belong to the system J, and the repertoire of signs is more restricted than in the diagram published by Archaic Bookkeeping. The syntax is limited only to signs belonging to system J noted in decreases order, and this notation adopts the notation of numbers in general in cuneiform texts. So the signs of system J integrate at the same time the numerical information and the meteorological information, and the order of magnitude are very large. It's more or less the same for the quantity, the tablets containing only lengths. The quantitative signs belong this time to system S. The syntax of quantities is limited only to signs belonging to system S. And there is no sign for specific sign for measurement unit. And the order of magnitude also are large or extra large. These tablets do not exhibit any connection between units of length and surface. In the following group, as in the Uruk 4 group, the order of magnitude are large or extra large. The quantitative signs belong to the system G for surface and to the system S for length. It's the same. But unlike in the Uruk 4 group, the measurement of lengths and corresponding surface appear in the same tablet. It means that there is a connection between length and surface and the possibility of a calculation of surface from length. And in this tablet, as a consequence, there is a bridge between unit of length and unit of surfaces. Other important feature, new feature, is that the sign GAN 2 for assyriologists, that is a specific sign, this one. You see this kind of drawing which represents an irrigated field. This sign is used after the signs which express area measurement of surfaces, which is new. I will see that it is very important. So, the apparition of this sign, GAN2, often written after measurement of surface, is perhaps one of the most important features of Uruk 3 from the Janet Nasser texts. I'll come back on this point later. In early dynastic 3A mathematical tables from Farah, like in the previous groups, the order or magnitude are very large, and the system J is used for surfaces, and the system S is used for length. But in these tablets, a specific sign, which is GAN2, is noted after the measurement of surface, and a specific sign, which is NINDA, is noted after the measurement of length. So And also, of course, you have, this is a table, that is, you have a list of lengths of square, of side of square, and the corresponding surface of surface of the square. That is, there is clearly a link between the measurement of length and the measurement of surfaces. In later texts, for example, in administrative texts from Girsu, dated early dynastic 3b, the metrology changed completely as multiples and submultiples appear. You have submultiples of the, here, submultiples of the ninda, that is one gi, two gi is one dida, indida, kush, which is the qubit, shudua and shusi, and a multiple esh, and the unit of surface gan is subdivided into 100 sa, which is a new unit, which is it's, itself subdivided in 60 gin. And here, of course, not only there is a bridge between lengths and surfaces, but there are two bridges between lengths and surfaces. To sum up, in the earliest group, there is no trace of connection between length and surface, so one can explore the hypothesis that the metrologies of surfaces and lengths were developed independently, for perhaps for different reasons, or by different actors, or at different times. And this is a hypothesis that we are exploring with my colleague Camille Lecomte. In the following group, dated Uruk 3, new features appear. The presence of the sign GAN2 after the signs of system G. And important feature, which is the subdivision, a decimal subdivision of the unit of surface that I represented in the second line. And a connection between the unit of length and the unit of surfaces, which makes possible to calculate areas from lengths. And in the group of mathematical tablets from Farah, the third line, the repertoire of signs is more or less unchanged too, but new features appear. A dyadic subdivision of the iku, it's not a decimal subdivision, but the unit of surface is subdivided in two, which is again subdivided in two. And there is the presence of the sign GAN2 after the signs of system J, and the presence of the sign NINDA after the signs of system S. That is, we observe the systematization of a use of a separate sign to designate the measurement unit in the sense of the reference surface, which is used to represent other surfaces. So one can explore the hypothesis that the measurement units for surfaces and lengths were an innovation of the end of the fourth millennium. That is, you see that the notion of a measurement unit would be a mathematical elaboration in a way, and this is another hypothesis that we are exploring with Camille Lecomte. And and of course there is a connection between lengths and surfaces. And in the third group, the surface measured are not only large, but also small and sometimes very small. The units of surface are the units of surface and lengths are completed by submultiples and multiples, and a second bridge between length and surface appears. So you see that while diagrams, which represent meteorological systems and numerical system, picture an apparent stability. You see the same diagrams I used for each situation. These diagrams picture an apparent stability in archaic and early dynastic periods. But this apparent stability through time and place, despite this stability, texts exhibit small variation and sometimes very important change, for example, in the repertoire of signs, syntax, and bridges. The diagram I used erased these variations. Moreover, I aggravated this bias by using the same diagrams, not only for archaic period, but for early dynastic period. So, and for other provenience. So the reason of that is that in my own reflection on ancient mythology, the diagram were powerful tools for analysis. And in a way, thanks to diagrams, I capture some important variations. So the variations, why are the variations important? Because they may reflect a mathematical work which reconfigured meteorological practices and concepts in relation to the very concept of measurement units for length and surface in this case, the building of a bridge between units of length and surface which appear to be a mathematical work, and in relation also to a unique concept of surface which integrates in the same concept large land and small field. And this is very bon, I wrote a paper on that in the context of the SOAP project, but this is a completely different, much more abstract notion of surfaces. So I jump to old Babylonian material. 5 minutes. So it will be very difficult. Okay, so I had just half an hour until now.
35 minutes.
Ah, okay. Well, I counted the 30 minutes.
You can continue longer, but then we have to shorten the Q&A. Yes,
well, I try to be short. So at the beginning of the second millennium before the Common Era, scribal schools flourished through the Near East. The most important were established in southern and central Mesopotamia, foremost in Nippur, but also Larsa, Uruk, Sippar, and Kish. This city has provided us with abundant school texts. And among the school material, meteorological lists and tables are of special interest as they show how masters and scholars understood and reconfigured the meteorology inherited from previous period in order to teach this meteorology and to use in mathematical work. So here is a meteorological list from Nippur. So this list contains a lot of information. For example, first, the relative value. The enumeration itself provides the relative value. For example, in the last column, you read one shoes, that is one finger, two finger, and so on, until eight finger, nine finger, and after that, one third couche, which means that 10 figure equal one couche, which gives the relationship between finger and couche, and so on and so on. And these provide the complete landscape of relative values of the unit, the one from the other. Other very important features which are provided by meteorological tables or lists and not by diagram is the granularity of measurement value. That is, you have a list of measures. It's not a continue, but it's a list of grain of value. And this is very important for mathematical and administrative practice, where you find concatenations of this grain. And the measurement value are noted, for example, here in the mathematical text as the concatenation of two grain, 1/3 gin and 15 she, and the same in administrative text from Lhasa and from other provenance. And this phenomenon was studied in detail by Robert Midet-Ekonlen in his book to appear soon. So, beside metrological lists, the school material include metrological tables. This is also a metrological list, but which provide another very interesting feature, which is the, you distinguish, this is a very good copy by Eleanor Robson, where you see well the vertical alignment, and the vertical alignment of the sign indicate the syntax of the measurement, since you have the numbers, the fractions, the measurement unit, and the third element, which is the name of the measurement, the magnitude which is measured. But you see the last item of the part that I copied, you have only two elements. And in the following column, you have only two elements. That is, in some instance, the syntax is not the common syntax into three elements, but in two elements. And this is clearly indicated in the metrological text. I don't have time to explain that. But one of the goals of the metrological tables was also to indicate the notation of numbers, the notation of measurement value, and the syntax of quantities. And beside that, another sort of text was used in scribal school, which are the so-called metrological tables, which contain exactly the same entry as the metrological lists, but in front of if measurement value, there is a number noted in sexagesimal place value notation, which indicate something more, very useful for the calculation, which is the bridge between lengths and surfaces. So, now, I would like just to underline the fact that metrological lists and tables provide a very detailed and precise information which are not in tables and diagrams, and which is much more rich. We have much more in the representation developed by the scribes themselves than in our representation. And well, I think it's a very important to aspect to understand the metrology. In conclusion, system or not system, in modern representation, especially diagrams, metrologies appears as system because you see this train of unit structured and which appear as structured and stable sets of units connected the one with the others. The ancient texts often reflect much more diverse and complex practices with metrology. In the case of archaic texts, the metrological systems appear to be in large part constructions of historians, but not only. And the factor diagram diagrams convey features such as stability, completeness, and consistency, which do not adhere completely to that of ancient practices. In the context of Old Babylonian scribal schools, the metrology as systems seem to be, in a way, an elaboration of ancient masters and scholars. And factory diagrams convey information and ideas similar to that conveyed by metrological distance table and tables, but less rich and less complex. In all cases, I think that factor diagrams are powerful tools, or tables are powerful tools for us to work on ancient mythology, but it is important to evaluate the distance between the representation and the historical phenomena these representations are supposed to reflect. Excuse for the time.
But I was given the microphone, as you noticed. No. There is something that struck me, which is a puzzle I have. And then after Jens, if I have time, I will go to my second question. I will only ask one for the moment. Somehow, for the archaic period, when you emphasized the disconnection between measurement of surfaces and measurement of lengths, you raised the question of how were surfaces measured, if not by computation?
Yes.
Which is a question that has been puzzling me for
exactly
a long time, but here, somehow it's you have to address it because there is apparently no computation of surfaces. So what is your idea?
Yes.
I don't know whether you have any.
This is exactly the point, because the different change I underlined, of course, are connected with a completely different method of evaluation. And an evaluation is not always a computation. This is the point. And they said, how did they evaluate the large surfaces in the Uruk 4 period? First, the first problem is why to evaluate large lands, and this is really I think it's connected to a political agenda. This is an outil pouvoir, a power tool to control land. The problem is which official control which lands. And the lands are, and this is very clear in archaic text. So the land are evaluated to make clear between opposite powers which land is under the control of which rule. This is not the, and this evaluation, in my view, is not a measure. It's a, there are very large set of surfaces which are used and passed the one to the other, but it's a global appreciation. But if you ask a peasant nowadays, in the country, and you ask them how, what is the surface of land you have? They never said the sides, they said the surface. And this surface is not at all evaluated from the side. They ignore the side. The sides has absolutely no importance. And perhaps they evaluate from the quantity of grain, for example, they can harvest on their fields. But this is not an evaluation by the multiplication of a length by the width. So the point is not to answer the question, because we need a lot of archaeological and textual evidence. The point is that the surface is not always the result of the multiplication of a length with a width. It appears in ancient texts, but I think that it's true today. And there is really an anthropological work to do on the evaluation of surfaces. And because, I stop here.
I totally agree that this unification of length and area measure is an important step. I even used that to define the step from mathematical techniques to mathematics.
Yes. Yes.
And that, I never thought about whether it was early Uruk 3, but there is this probably school text which is used to show that they had the surveyor formula was used because the average.
Yes, yes.
Is that Uruk 3 or Uruk 4?
No, it's later. Later, the field with Camille, we tried to collect all of the fields text from Uruk 3, Uruk 4, Uruk 3, and later. And the, in a way, all of the text dated Uruk 3 come from Djemnet Nasr first, and all of the texts, the field texts in this collection are those we have collected. There are 15, and the okay. So I think more or less we have all of them. And after what you say appear in early dynastic texts, not before.
Well, this text, as far as I remember, it only gives a length, and the only reason that we think it is connected to the surveyor formula is that the lengths are made so as to make an easy calculation.
Yes. Yes, and in Girsu text, you have a lot of use of the surveyor formula, a lot of use, a practice of approximations, and so on, which is completely absent from the previous text.
This is rather a remark than a question, but from what you presented made me think of something which I have been working on, which I have been reading. What I have in mind in specific is the 1978 article by David Pingree on the history of mathematical astronomy in India. Now, in this article, Pingree divides Indian astronomers into six or seven groups, especially which he calls schools. And my impression is that the idea of schools here is somewhat similar with what you presented as systems. So. Mm-hmm. Pingree divides the scores according to the parameters, astronomical parameters used by the astronomers. And delivering his ideas, he frequently uses tables where he puts various parameters like the motion of planets, etc. And he puts these tables, which will give the strong impression that different astronomers are using similar parameters, and so that they can be divided into different groups. But now, actually, if we look carefully into the text, the parameters that appear in Pingree's tables actually do not appear in the text themselves. They are a result of computations of different things by Pingree, sometimes appear directly or indirectly in the text and are computed by Pingree, and he puts them to enhance his ideas. It's not that I have a strong conclusion from this, but I think that the usage of tables is something very strong, and sometimes I don't have much to say about the usage of diagrams in these cases, but I just wanted to mention this. Thank you very much.
Yes, but I agree, but the two points is that first, the tables provide convey a picture of the metrology, which is stability and consistency and so on. So I don't see that the tables are not useful. Of course, we need them, but I just draw the attention on the fact that they convey other idea, which are idea and information. And the second point I try to underline is that the ancient scribes in the scribal scroll had their own representations of the mythology. And these, and in their own representation and mythology, looking at closely to them, you understand very important ideas that they inject in these representations, that they developed for teaching purpose. C'est là, c'est. Thank you.
You see, are you able to infer much about the larger social context against which they're taking place? Is it just about increasing institutionalization or education of scribes, or is there more going on?
But in my idea, this is a work in progress. Mm. So my idea is that there is a completely different institutional context, but different purpose for calculating surfaces in Uruk 4 period, which is the context is the rivality between state city mm-hmm. and the control of the of large part of the country, and in the for example in the early dynasty Djemnet Nasr, I don't know enough the context, but in early dynastic texts from far, the context is completely different. It's more a bureaucratic context, that is official of high level, which are serving the king, for example, and which and were in charge of management of agricultural production and so on. So perhaps it's a much more technical than perhaps. And the first group is much more political. And other difference is that the far texts I shown you are mathematical texts because they are organized in a very regular fashion. And in a mathematical text, the goal of a mathematical text, we can suppose that it's not the same as the goal of a text produced by a bureaucracy. And my idea is that in these mathematical texts from the different period of early dynastic texts are mathematical elaboration. They give more than an information about the relationship between lengths and surfaces. This is an elaboration, a more broad elaboration on the concept of measurement units and on the relation between lengths and surfaces. And on the calculation itself, mm-hmm. which is new in this corpus.
Thank you very much. Yes, I think this was an intriguing presentation, and I think you made many very important points, and I want just also in way of a comment say in which I see the importance, and maybe you agree to this, maybe this is trivial for everybody who's here, but since we want to think more generally about the relation of practices and societal conditions and the cognition that goes with it, I want to make the general remark that I think this is a perfect example that shows how a symbolic means, by tools and the concepts that go with them grow out of the practices and of the administrative needs, and only in the course of history and in the course of these the development of these administrative practices become more generalized and more integrated. And naively, of course, one thinks of mathematics being used in administration, one thinks of an application, one thinks one has an abstract or general symbolic system or schema that one then applies to the practical purposes that are there. But this perfectly shows, I think, that it's the other way around, you start with concrete practical problems that are given by the form of society or the concrete problems the society is confronted with. And through the course of history, you get more integrated systems. Like you said, the systems of measurement get a larger range of applicability. They get more integrated.
Yes.
You get connections between length and area.
Yes.
And to begin with, it's not a relation of pure multiplication. I mean, you have matching units to begin with. Only later, then with the sexagesimal place value system, you also get a more general form of multiplication and so on. I just wanted to point out that I think this is a perfect case to make this general observation, if you agree.
Thank you.
Is that time for another remark or not? So, in fact, it was something I wanted to say yesterday about many things we heard about India. And what you suggested added to this remark. I wanted to emphasize, you said, the introduction of a measurement unit as a mathematical work.
Yes.
There is something which is extremely striking for me, and that was very striking yesterday. When we speak of standards, we are struck by the fact that we have meters like this and meters like that. But in contrast to this variation in the absolute value, there is something absolutely amazingly stable in the relationship between the units that are designated. So there is a huge stability in the relationship between the names of the units.
But not in the values.
And not in the value, which seems to indicate that, in fact, units might have been a tool of computation, like when we use decimal system and we have 100 and 10 and 1. They might have been tools of computation with units. And they might have been replaced, at least for us, by another tool of computation, which is, for instance, something like decimal system. But I think that we ought to consider connected measurement units as tools of computation to begin with, and perhaps less as standard for measurement.
Yes,
that was my suggestion. Yesterday, it was striking already that you had values that were absolute values that were completely different, but the relationship.
If I can add something, we have a problem in English with the word standard, because in French, we have a word for standard and a word for étalon. And it's not the same meaning. And an étalon, this is, I would need this word special, as an étalon is a reference quantity. And the other quantity are expressed in relation to this reference quantity. But it doesn't mean that the reference quantity is standardized. It may change. The building a metrological system, if you want, from some reference quantities, it's a phenomenon which is distinct from another phenomenon, which is a standardization.
Yeah. I just wanted to add, I think the early Mesopotamian commodity-specific number systems show your point very clearly. Because, I mean, this is mainly how do you write these numbers? You repeat the one unit as many times as you have it. And if you reach a certain next unit, then you use that to replace all the others. So I think it comes out of computation or it's a constructive, additive way of writing these numerals. So they come out of the practice of addition and calculation, I think. I mean, I don't know if you...
So it is to be added that there are some from Uruk 5, there are some tablets which do not bundle.
Go on and on and on. Yes.
To 11 or 12, not stopping at 9. Yeah. No further than that.
Okay.
Which shows that the bundling before that was made physically, that a larger basket.
Yes.
So thank you. Thank you, Christine.
So, désolé, tout le monde a faim.